It is my pleasure this morning to introduce, I'm Virgie Green, I've got some new people here, and I'm pleased to introduce the chairman of the National Maritime Historical Society, Ron Oswald, who will introduce our speaker. Ron is a Revolutionary War amateur historian, but he has also been the person who has been, who brought the idea of the National History Day to the National Maritime Historical Society. And this is over 600,000 students, junior high and high school students, who work with their schools across the country on a history project. And with this history project, they can do any number of they can do a website or a paper or a presentation or documentary there are different things that they can do, but we want to encourage these students who are excited about history to learn about maritime history. And so at this point now we give cash prizes and certificates in 25 states, and we're working up. We started a few years ago in New Jersey, which was wrong, and he realized how important this is. So that is one of the many projects that he is bringing to our country. So with no further ado, I'll get out of here, Ron.
Thank you, Virgie. I really didn't intend to talk about History Day, but I'll just say a few words about it. If you ever get a chance to attend one of these contest sessions, you'll actually be quite amazed at the quality of work that these kids have done. And we found it really an exciting program to participate in. And as Virgie said, we've grown it from starting with one state contest to this year we're offering our prizes in 25 different states, East Coast, West Coast, South, Midwest, so on. To move on to today's subject, really thank you all for coming. As Virgie mentioned, it's kind of gray out there, so there's no better place to be than in here. Tugboats are a really fascinating subject. I can't explain why, but I would hope with our speaker today, Paul Farrell, that we'll go away with some insights into what makes these boats such a fascinating subject. And I'll also throw in a brief commercial for Paul's book. I don't get any commission on this, but I took a quick look at the book, and it's really fabulous. So after the talk, take a look at the book. I think he's got quite a supply there, so you don't want to run out.
I don't think I'll run out.
Paul has worked as an architect for, it's 45 years, I believe you said. And he comes from lives in the Boston area, and as he put in, he sent us some biographical information, which most of which I'm going to skip over, but there's a couple lines in here. He had started out at Virginia Tech, and at some point hitchhiked to Boston and forgot to leave. So while there, he studied at the Boston Architectural College and at MIT, and as I mentioned earlier, has worked as an architect now for 45 years. As he also puts it, Tugboats Illustrated is his first book, implying optimistically that there'll be something to follow. And so with that, let's give a warm welcome to Paul Farrell.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction, and thank Birchie and Howard Slotnick, the chairman, and out of all the volunteers that are helping, the ones I know are Jessica and Ab, who's making me not anxious about IT, which is probably the thing that scared me the most about doing this, and I didn't...
You don't tell me to be loud.
Sure, there's no microphone. So, so this is, I don't think I told the society, but this is the first time I've done this, so we'll have to we'll struggle through it together, I guess, and see how far we get. But I thought I would answer a few questions that come up. Why tugs, or why did I choose tugs, and why did it take 25 years to write this book? Save a little time in the signing line. We can all get to lunch earlier if I put those to bed early. So why tugs? I when I moved to Boston, it was in the late 60s, and I hadn't been near a seaport for a while, an active seaport, so I was very interested to go down to the harbor, and those were the days of break bulk shipping when things were unloaded in cargo nets and before containers, and it was a pretty exciting place, a lot going on, all the smaller ships then, and the dock workers, and they used to say that nobody stole more than the Boston stevedores, because they wouldn't have it. They wouldn't stand for it. So it was really fun to be there, and one of the most interesting things was the tugs. And I think a lot of designers, a lot of architects like tugs, and I think the reason is that we're so jealous of the naval architects who can take something that's so absolutely functional and just because of the things it has to do, it becomes such an interesting shape. It's just so much more and easier to enjoy than architecture is very difficult, because you're always trying to make a box look nice a lot of the times. But they just have so much to work with for tugs. So I really got interested in tugs, and then I had worked in an architect's office that had a kind of partial view of the harbor, so I would see like three tugs come up from the inner harbor, and then two of them would loop out, and the third one would disappear behind this building, and then in a few minutes I would see the ship come in, and the tug I could see would curve up and go alongside, and they would tie off on the side of the ship, and then as it came into view, there was the third tug was behind, tied off, and sort of got interested in the functions of how all that worked, and so I got a book out of the library, and then that raised, I learned a lot and brought up more questions, so I got another book, and I ended up with a stack of about six books about tugs, and I was really kind of getting into it, and I thought, well, maybe there's a book here that takes these six books and would be for people like me, who are just interested in things and whatever direction it takes. So maybe I can do a book that brings all this together and kind of gives a real overview of the whole business. And I was interested in trying to talk about the business side and the technology side and the history, the seamanship, the craftsmanship. So just the whole range of things that are in any business, and just pick this business in particular because it had a lot of charm and interest to it, it in itself. So I put together a proposal and sent it around and got a book contract in 1996, delivered the book in 2016. We have to thank Norton, the publisher, for one thing, staying in business, and for another, following through four editors on the way to finish. I wore out four editors. So I thought what I'd do is just talk a little, go through the book and just, like I saw that one of your previous speakers like built a Viking ship and sailed it across the ocean and came and talked to you about it. So this is more like an internal voyage here of like how the book came about and kind of what I was getting at with the book. So we'll see how it goes here. And like I said, this is the first time, so I'm sure we're all friends here. So bear with me. So yeah, this is the cover, which like one of the things I found out about publishing is that they're very interested in what's in the book, but they're absolutely in control of what's on the cover because they're the ones making the sale. So I spent the entire time I worked on the book trying to find pictures of tugs doing things, and I didn't want to just pictures of tugs. And they said, "Here's your cover, pictures of tugs, not doing anything." And in fact, it's confusing because there are three tugs here. There's two McAllister tugs, and then the W.O. Decker. And this photograph was taken by Will Van Dorp, who runs a tugster blog. So they chose it, but I was happy to see he got some recognition because he does a really good job. So the 25 years, I mean, a lot of it had to do with the fact that when I started out, I had an idea for the book, and I started doodling what I would like to have in it, and I was going to sort of preparing the way for an illustrator who was going to do really like beautiful artwork. So I would do the sketches as I laid out pages about what I wanted him to do, and it just got really hard to find an illustrator who could, it's almost like read my mind, because there were a lot of things I wanted to show in the drawings. So as time went on, I kept doing these drawings, and I realized maybe I could do it, and it would work out okay if I thought of them as cartoons. You know, I would like take the pressure off. So they're not fine arts. These are just doodles and cartoons, and you know, they tell the story. They're functional. They kind of do the job. So this, I think, when I did this one, might have been when I was deciding maybe I can do this myself. But that did mean a lot of Saturdays and evenings doing these drawings, because they weren't easy, and it's not a facility I had really a strong ability in. So it took a while to find a way that I could do something acceptable. So that's part of the 25 years, and plus renovating a few houses in the meantime and raising a few kids and trying to save an old bridge and a lot of other things that got in the way. But I don't know, I stayed with it, and Norton stayed with me, so that was really nice. So and the other thing that was really important to me was the photographs. And so it took a lot of time selecting photographs, and over 20 years, like I got this picture in 1998, and the photographer said, "Oh yeah, you can use it." And I didn't realize until 2016 that I had to get his release form. And of course, he had died. And then I thought, well, but then he left his collection to the Maryland Historical Archives, I think. So I said, oh, that's good, because that's a public agency. They'll know where things are. So I got in touch with them, and they said, well, the only trouble is he left the commercial rights to some woman. And they gave me her name, and I tried for a year to get in touch with her, and I couldn't do it. So I finally had to, this is like the publication date was coming up, and I had to give up on this. And so I went, I found this online, what I liked about the other one was this kind of swooping line that a lot of the interest of tugs is the kind of roundness that they need to have in order to work up alongside ships. So then I found this a couple times, that when I was thwarted in getting a picture, turned out there was another route that actually turned out a little better. So I got this picture, which I really liked, much more, a lot of color in the you know, rusty ship in the background. So this, and the other thing that took a long time of putting the book together was that I kind of saw it as like a magazine layout. I wanted it to be very open and kind of accessible. So I decided that this is a double page, each set of facing pages would be one topic, and I would, it meant I had to design the book as opposed to having the book designer design it. I had to lay out each page to make sure everything fit on the page, and I, so that added a lot of time and sort of complication, but I did learn how to design books as part of that. So when the ingredients are that I always had, or almost on all pages, I had a photograph with a really detailed caption that I felt like I was doing the right thing if when you read the caption, every sentence you had to look at the picture, and then, you know, go back to the caption, and like you're watching a tennis game when the caption was on the side. And then the next thing was a block of text which described the general topic. And then the third thing was almost always a drawing. So those three things occur on all the pages. So so that added time also, because I was having to make every page make sense pretty much on its own. And this was something Ron said about, you know, why is it we like tugs? And one of the best reviews I got was from a photographer professional mariner who spent a lot of time on boats, and he said the one thing in the review that he liked was that I seemed to get at what it is that makes tugs so appealing, even to tug crews who might have retired and then just decided they wanted to come back, and what is it that they didn't even focus on, maybe that had to do with what was so appealing to them. So I had this, and this was a page that I had to fight the editors because they weren't that interested in it, I thought, but it's in generally about what the appeal is, what associations you make with what's a machine. But, you know, this is a machine that people kind of invest with a lot of feeling or human characteristics, like we assign human characteristics to, in this case, tugs. And one of the best examples is Little Toot. This guy was one of the top five or six watercolorists in the country when he was working, but he also did these books. And what I like is that it's not an abstraction. He really looked at the real thing, and then he modified it into a personification. And then I guess the other thing is the associations that you might have, because tugs are kind of smaller for ships, but they've got everything a ship has all kind of packed together. So being an architect, I wanted to do a little architecture too. So I was making this mirror image comparison of how like a house the tug is, and even the superstructure is called the house, and it sits in a big deck. The deck has to be wide for line handling, so it's sitting in almost like a landscape. So then I did my own version of what would a tug-like house be. And so I got to draw a little arc, and actually that's 98 was the year I drew this, so that's how long I've been working on this. But it really got at what is so appealing about tugs. Why do people have a good, like an emotional reaction to them? You see them all the time in movies whenever somebody wants to make things interesting. This was another picture lesson I learned, that sometimes you don't have and didn't learn till late. When the book designer started putting this together, he some of the pictures had to be small because the resolution wasn't big enough to print. So I ended up with some postage stamp sort of drawings if I wanted them. But this was if you're all interested in history, this is something I found in Conway's History of the Ship. There was a guy named Basil Gardner, I think, who edited like six books. And when I'm thinking of it, it took me 25 years to do one. He edited six, and I think he wrote some other ones. But So it was a good, in England, he's a good resource. So this, and the other thing, it, just similar to the house, tug-like house, was the interesting thing to me about tugs is they're not like a ship, they're not this singular thing, but they're always in a, they're made to be in association with other things, with ships or with barges or, and coming, you know, always working close to shore. So it gave me an opportunity to, you know, draw things like a tidal basin. And so this is the history of before tugs, how people moved ships around. And then this was like a year of work that didn't even get in the book. I did a whole series on, they say follow your nose, but you know, I followed it into a dead end, it turned out. But so I did a whole series, and I learned about and drew about steam engines and steam power. And then in the end, the editor said, you know, you're not doing Wikipedia here, so just stick to the tugs. So I had a whole, so now you can see them because you won't see them in the book, but a whole series of the when they used to use condensed steam inside a cylinder to make a vacuum and suck water up, and then use gunpowder to make a vacuum, which was an internal combustion, but didn't have much of a future for being practical. And then these big engines that they had in England that pumped out mines, and then the separate condensing. So that was like probably a year's work that just didn't make it into the book. There's another photograph from the history of the ships, which I thought it was interesting. There's also a crowd here gathered to see what could go wrong, just waiting for an interesting problem. And this looks like a pretty dangerous maneuver. This is a side wheel tug in England. So this was actually one of the 15 pages that I sent out to publishers to try to get a book contract. And the person from Norton who contacted me said, you know, I took a whole stack of proposals home to look at, and I had to fight with my husband over who was going to read this one first as bedtime reading. So that was from Norton, and they signed me up. But so it is, you know, back in 95, this was, you know, I had this sort of cute picture of the tug, and then I had this cutaway to try to show how a steam tug worked. And I'll show you a sequence of, so this is my first sketch out, trying to develop this and show what all the pieces were. And very crude, and then this was when I had to put the labels on, just, and then this I'm trying to lay out the form, because I'm not really a kind of a natural artist, so I had to do this, and at some point I was doing this at home, and I had architect's tracing paper, and I drew a drawing, and then I would take another piece of trace, and I'd put it over the top, and just layers, and my wife Gloria said, oh, is that how artists work? I said, no, that's how architects work. just keep on piling up papers and getting it wrong, less wrong every time until you end up with something that seems okay. So this is like starting to get the engine and the boilers. This is kind of pulling it all together without some of the deck equipment. This is the kind of the last thing before the final drawing. And there's the final drawing. There's what I wanted the color to be. And at the end, the book designer was putting the color on, and we didn't get to this page, really. And then the points where the labels were supposed to go. And this is the page in the book. This is two pages, and I spliced them together. But so that was the kind of a sequence I had to go through to get the drawings done. I got very interested in process, like the process of maneuvering and things and arcane problems that came up. So one of the issues in the early days of diesel tugs was that they didn't have any reversing transmission. So in order to go from forward to reverse, you had to stop the engine and push a lever over so it would start running in the other direction. And then you had to restart the diesel. And then they used compressed air sprayed into the cylinders to get the diesel running, pumping again in the other direction. So it was to run out of air when you were maneuvering because you've gone back and forth too much was a very dangerous thing. And was that something that you wouldn't think about that the captains had to keep in mind all the time. So this is, there are two sequences here. One is the letter sequences of this ship coming into harbor against a tidal current. And then, so all the steps it takes to come in and go past the entrance and be pushed down as you back in. And then the other sequence that's going on is for the green tug, all the stops and starts and reverses. It would take eight reverses. So you know, I had to really keep track of the air you were using up. So I really enjoyed that kind of. It's a thing you wouldn't think of, but it was very serious to them to end up with no air and be in the middle of a maneuver and be carried down the river. So I just thought that was an interesting. It's like the whole book kind of doesn't, there's no need for this book except that it's just interesting. It's like the more you dig into it, the more things you have to think about when you're doing this, or in this business. And then the photographs, this photo I like because it gives you a scale because it has the guy and you can see the size of the propeller. And if you think about this thing turning over and to the right, you can imagine when that's in the water, the force on the water, and just got to get a sense of how the whole system worked, how it moves. And then there was one of the things that was interesting is that turns out there are different methods for ship handling in the U.S. and in Europe, which had really big implications on the differences in the vessel. So it's really a kind of a historical issue. So the American method was alongside, where the tug comes up alongside the ship in the outer harbor, and they put up a line. They wouldn't put up this many lines, really. That was just for artistic license at one time. But you put up a line, and the ship basically tows the tug through the outer harbor, and then when they get close to the berth, the tug starts to maneuver the ship. But it's all, as one tug captain said, when he came to talk to our World Ship Society meeting, and it's a Dorchester guy, and he said, "Tugboating's a contact sport." So the American style is big into you think of America banging into things, you know. It's like you innovate, you know, like improvising and banging into things, I think, seem to be the American way of doing things. So and this is just how different ways that they would connect the hawsers when they were bringing a ship through. And this is a picture where this tug is actually being towed by the tanker as they come into the harbor. And the line, you can't really see it here very well, but it's the line is up there, and the engine is shut down on the tug, so it's being towed along by the ship. And I was on one of these, a newer tug, but in this doing this maneuver, and you're down on the bow, and the line, which is about the size of a fire hose, they say it's bar tight. It's this stretched so tight that it kind of quivers, and if you touch it, it's like touching metal, even though it's a manila hawser. So it's pretty, there's a lot of force going through the whole resistance of that tug being pulled by the ship. And it's a scary kind of thing, it was to me, to be down on the deck, and there's four stories of ship, like right next to the tug, and then the rubber fenders and the tires and all the squealing and squeaking, and it was a pretty dramatic place to be. So this is how, in the American style, they have the H bits on the bow and the stern, which are big in this case steel tubes. And the way to secure the tug to the ship is just multiple wraps of the hawser around these bits. And this one is, I think you're connected temporarily by this bow bit, but they would take that off to do work, and all the force would be on here, where this guy's like stacking up wraps here. And one of the issues is that this is really good because you can, like, the eye end goes to the ship, and that's fixed. The other end is just a live end of the hawser. There's no loop or anything, so you can make it up at any distance you want, or you can improvise a little bit. But one of the problems is that you, in order to release this, to release a tug, when I was there, the captain, as we were coming closer to the berthing, he wanted to move his tug back a little bit. So he had the deckhand as this like bar type hawser was stretched out. He had the tug deckhand loosen up some wraps until there was just it just kind of overcame the resistance of the friction, and the line started to pull out and the tug moved back. But it's, if you can think of doing that, like this, the deckhand had his hands in all this as all these wraps were coming and going, and under thousands of pounds of pressure, it was a pretty scary thing. But so you can't really release in an emergency easily. So all the tugs have, they'll have an axe on at the bow on the house. There's an axe at the stern. There's an axe on each side. So what you're supposed to do if the tug starts to get pulled sideways or pulled under by the ship going in an unexpected direction, you're supposed to take a whack at the hawser right near the H bit, and the other end will go flying off with enough force that would kill somebody it hit. So that was sort of a disadvantage to this style, but it was it lends itself to a lot of multiple ways to approach things. You know, you can every captain can have his own style. And then the contrast with that is the European method, where they had, in this case, a side wheel steamer, but they had a hook on each end, and then all their hawsers had an eye on each end, so that there was always a fixed distance between the ship and the tug, so that the and they didn't come alongside at all. They stayed kind of separate. And this is just how they would, the ship would be under power and the tugs would be separate, but trying to pull the bow and the stern to help maneuver it. And then when they got close, they would use the ship's winches to start to pull the ship in, as opposed to the US style, which was, you know, get a couple of tugs with big fenders on the front and start shoving. And, you know, like the one docking pilot that I rode with, he would call to the tugs, "Shake them up." It just meant, you know, give it all you got and shove it over to the dock. And so this was a much more subtle, a kind of refined version. And so this is how they, so there's a line there, and the tug has a line off the stern. And the tugs are not very fendered, or you know, they're all, I think it has a little bit, I've seen some pictures of English tug captains, and they're all dressed up with brass buttons and navy blue uniforms and things. So I think there's something to the idea that, you know, I have my ship, you have your bigger ship, and there's another ship in the back, and we're all captains of our ships, and we're not gonna, you know, we're gonna do this in a dignified manner. So they would, the one benefit of that was that those hooks have a lanyard that goes up to the pilot house, and if anything goes wrong, you just they pull that lanyard, and the hook is very heavy, and it drops, and the line goes off. So it gives them a lot more safety. And I did see a video of if you're familiar with the Cruisen Stern, it's a sail training ship that was, I think, German reparations to Russia, And now the Russians have it, and it's pretty famous for kind of running into things. there was actually a tug that was turned over and sank because it took some unexpected maneuver, or they may have difficulties with controlling engines because they were under power at the time. And a tug got turned over and sank, and everybody was rescued. And then they were in Iceland, and they ran into a couple of Icelandic Coast Guard ships that were docked near them. And then there was a video I saw where taken from the cruising stern, and there was a Dutch tug passing in the back, and it was a European tug, but it had the H bits, and it had the wraps on the H bits, and somehow there was some miscommunication, and the bit was on the stern, and all of a sudden the tug started to get dragged backwards, in the stern quarter went under the water, and the tug was being dragged under and was going to be sunk. And you can see in the behind the H bit, right next to the back of the cabin, there's a guy there who takes a hatchet and bam, and the hawser just shattered and flew back toward the cruising stern, and they freed themselves. But they would have been dragged under if they hadn't done that. So, and it made me think, well, why was there a Dutch tug with H-bits? Because they should have been working on a hook like the European method. And I think it had to do with, and this is history again, in World War II, they built the Mulberry Harbors for the D-Day invasion, precast concrete in the U.S., and they towed them across for the D-Day invasion, and a lot of those tugs were just sold in Europe, and so I think maybe the Dutch had one. This tug was newer, but had that experience, and they liked the H-bits, so that's why they had them on that tug. So they did connect a little bit. So there, and all globalization has now kind of made everything across the world the same, so that now they have tractor tugs that have a drive underneath, either a cycloidal drive or a rudder propeller, and they can apply force in any direction, 360 degrees. So now tugs are fendered all the way around like the American tugs, because they can push it any direction, and they have now the hawsers are a little smaller because they're plastic, and winches are smaller because of miniaturization, so they're able to have to work off the stern at a fixed length, but then also adjust the length by working the winch as they're working the ship. So those two methods have now merged into one worldwide method of ship handling, you know, until the time when there are no more people on tugs and they're all automated, and this will all be history. So this is one of the cycloidal tugs. In dry docks, you can see these fins here, and then this brown thing is a plate that protects the fins underneath. But the reason this is interesting was that this is a German system, and there only one company makes it, Voith. So I did this drawing of how this system works. Basically, this gear from the shaft turns a crown wheel that turns everything that's in green here, and so that spins these fins around. And if they're in alignment, they just spin in a circle. And they don't really do anything. But if you want to move in a direction, you use this joystick, which goes through this gimbal, and it moves the linkages, and when the fin passes the direction you want to go, it kicks out and gives you a little force in that direction, and when it gets to the opposite side, it kicks in and gives push in that direction. So it's a really intricate system, and very elegant, very, very mechanical. But and I had contacted the Voith people, and their chief naval architect was very interested, and he really got into the fact that I liked his drive system and I was able to explain it. And so he sent me books, and it was, we were having just a great old time. And then, so I thought, well, why don't I send you him a draft of my book in process? And so I did that, and I needed to get some pictures from him. And so I sent it off, and after a few weeks, I didn't hear anything. And so I sent an email, and I didn't get an answer. And I emailed more assistance to him, and I didn't get an answer. And I just couldn't figure it out. And I finally realized what had gone wrong, which was, and this didn't make it into the book, but at one time I had this North Atlantic, it was a page about literature and art and tugs. So I had this drawing of the North Atlantic and the Gulf Stream coming out between Florida and Cuba and going up across the North Atlantic and opening up the sea lane to Murmansk, which was the route to bring material from the US and England to Russia, our allies then. One of the things I talked about was Farley Mowat, who was a nature writer. He wrote Never Cry Wolf, but when he was young, he worked on a salvage tug in Nova Scotia out in the North Atlantic. So he wrote a book about that, so I was mentioning that. And then I was also mentioning, there was a Dutch tug captain who, just before World War II, wrote a book about the Dutch history in towing, and it became a anthem for the Dutch about Dutchness, I guess. So when the Germans came in, he had to leave. So he came over to England, and he participated in the rescue salvage tugs that went with the convoys up from Scotland to Murmansk. And he later became a Hollywood film writer and wrote one of the movies he wrote was The Key, about these tug captains who would go off on their suicidal mission and would give the key to this apartment, which also included Sophia Loren. And how they would pass the key on, I guess. And kind of describing the Murmansk run, I was reverted to my 9-year-old kid when I was supposed to do my homework, doing little sketches of, bombers and torpedoes and sinking ships. So I had that little vignette up here, and it was right near the end of the book. And I'm sure this poor guy who hadn't even been born when World War II ended, and he was happily reading about tugboats, and then, somebody shoved in his face, the Germans and World War II and the Nazis. So I'm sure that's why he stopped communicating. So there's geopolitical issues with writing a book, apparently. So that was too bad. But then I couldn't get his photographs. So it actually turned out, another case where I thought things came out even better because I couldn't get what I wanted, which would have been sort of a commercial pictures that they would have. So then I had to go. So then I went back looking, and I found this Crowley tug out of the water. And what was really interesting, it's one thing, it's very dramatic because it's nighttime, and most of the pictures in the book, the sky fades into the page, so it's there's not that big block of darkness, which I thought was interesting. And the other thing was that because it was at night and it was lit up, you could actually see the drives underneath, because generally in a picture in the daytime, that would be the part in shadow. So it was really interesting that it was the kind of backwards effect of what you normally see. So it actually, I think, was made the book much better for having to go and find a substitute. And then I also found this from Foss Maritime out in the West Coast of, again, these are guys, I think, scaling off rust on the on this pad underneath the drives, but you can see the drives, the fins here that would turn. And just the idea that guy's just there in a place that if this was underwater and the engine was on, that would be like a maelstrom of steel blades turning around. So it was nice to see that kind of contrast. This is another picture where I got I like the scale, the rudder propeller, but you can because it was a launching that you could see the size, and that, you know, tugs are, you think of them as cute little things, but they're not generally little. And this is the drawing of the rudder propeller drives. This was included because I like the naval architects' computer drawings. I think they're just very beautiful. This is a little tug that works in Vancouver. It's actually like 5,000 horsepower, but the piers are very close together and old, so they can't have a big tug, but they put incredible amount of power into these little tugs. But I really liked just the drawing of these old aircraft tires for fendering, but just the beauty of those tires sort of in perspective, I really liked. And this is the one that I showed at the beginning. This is in that series, and this is where I thought, well, maybe I can do this well enough to do the drawings myself. And then I thought of them as cartoons, and then I thought it would be funny just to do a cartoon as one. So I had this one showing a canal tug and how it's approaching the bridge, and these guys are all in a panic, and then it turns out that the pilot house is retractable, and the mast gimbals down so they can go underneath. So now the guys are calm here. This is the title of the page, Canal Towing. I wanted it to say, meanwhile back at the canal or something, but the editor didn't like that. So and this actually informed something else I did. I was trying to save this 1906 swing bridge over the Northern Avenue Bridge in Boston over the Fort Point Channel. So this was a competition that they held, and this was my entry to tell them to just freaking save the thing. So it was the same approach.
Did you save it?
Huh?
Did you save it?
Well, we'll know in about 6 months. I think the city's going to make a decision. So that's another thing. Like the book, 1996 to 2016, The Bridge, I started in 1998, and now we'll find out in probably 2018. So at this fine projects that have shorter than 20 years of span. So this is up the river, and I have some pages. I wanted to include all kinds of towing. And so mule towing is towing, so I wanted to make sure I had that. So this is the Erie Canal, and this actually is from a Parenton Museum on the canal. But this is one sort of beside the point, but interesting. This mule wouldn't go on the boat. So they're using this mule to pull the other mule onto the boat. So then I got interested in process again. I realized the Erie Canal only has a towpath on one side, and it's got traffic in both directions. So how does that work? So one of the things I thought was interesting was how do the teams cross the towpath when they get to an obstruction? So I invented the old swimming rock here that the path couldn't continue, so it had to cross. So in order to get from one side, to get the team from one side to the other, they made these truss bridges that were very low, and they could drag the hawser around the top, and they don't have to disconnect the mules. And then at the other side, they just invented the cloverleaf intersection so that you could come back down and under, and you still don't have to disconnect the team, just keep on going. So that was a sort of interesting process that led to being able to talk about engineering and architecture too. And then the other thing was, how do they cross? So one team has to stop and let their line drop to the bottom, and then their team moves over to the side, and then in this case the red boat passes over the line, and the boat passes over the line, which is sunk. So they had all this choreography they had to do to to keep moving because of the towpath was only on one side. So this was a revelation to me, and this is I think a good explanation of why I wanted to have drawings and photographs, because this is a photograph of a chain steamer, mostly in Europe. A few of them were in the U.S., but in a really fast flowing river, a lot of the times the tugs weren't strong enough to fight the current, so they would lay a chain for 100, 200 miles down the river, and then they had there was a winch and a steam engine on here that would drag the chain through, and they would drag themselves forward. So they didn't have to worry about being pulled downstream because they were on the chain, which was, you know, thousands of pounds, it was 100 miles long. So all they had to do was apply their power just to move in ahead. So I never heard of such a thing, and it was pretty interesting technology. And then that's the reality, which I think is important. You see the picture, because in order to make the drawings, I had to exaggerate things and change things around to make them fit. So you wouldn't think. So this is explaining the mechanism and the process. So that was why I thought it was valuable to both have a picture and have the drawing, because a lot more could be explained in the drawing, but you don't really get the big sense of it in the drawing. So this was on the Mississippi, how they deal with all the curves and bends. And so downstream they use the pivot point, which is the center of resistance, which if there's more resistance on the bow as you go forward, the center of resistance goes forward. So there's this pivot point, which is the point. And so they make use of that by powering and not powering in how they sweep around the bends. And then my 9-year-old self here, in order to show how big these rafts of barges are, I showed a nuclear aircraft carrier on top of one, and it gave me a chance to draw little F-18s, blue airplanes. So I think one of the things that I enjoy about the book is that I didn't take myself out of it. You know, I was the one telling the story, and so you get the sense that somebody's telling you something, and they have their own weird way of looking at things. So that part of it I enjoy. Will Van Dorp, the Tugster guy, put a very good review on it. He put this picture in, and then this drawing, and somebody sent him a letter saying, oh, that's not how we do it. If you go downstream that way, you'll end up on the bank. So anybody who's going down the Mississippi, don't refer to my book to navigate. So this was a picture that I put in, which does, you know, have a sense of danger of rescue and salvage. So it was pretty good. It wasn't really what I wanted, and this is what I wanted. I mean, that is, you know, if you look through 1,000 photos, that's the photo of rescue salvage right there. So this is a China government rescue ship. So I got in touch with them, but I was in touch with a woman who knew the photographer, and so I thought I was all set. And then I lost interest in trying to find the guy, and so in the end I couldn't use this picture. It was really a shame. So it went off. So I couldn't get in touch with anyone in this Chinese agency. So I sent the book went off to be published, ironically, in China. And after it was gone, I went to an international towing conference in Boston, and one of the booths was a guy who sold deck equipment from Singapore, and one whole side of his booth was that picture, or this picture, blown up enormous. And it was just so frustrating, and he said, oh yeah, I know that guy, I could have gotten that picture for you. That's really, maybe if they reprint, they'll let me change it. But that was one where the picture went the wrong direction, it got worse instead of better. This was like me again, just I'm trying to show how pulling a ship off the shore, and then I have my homage to Richard Scarry, because I really liked, it was really influenced by his, you know, what do people do all day, you know? It's like, he tells kids, like, here are pipes, and here's the reality, but in a nice way, but he's very practical. Like, kids can deal with sort of knowledge like that, and they're interested. So my homage was to, and I didn't want to get any copyright trouble or something, so I have Gold Bugs Bulldozer, but it's being driven by Lowly Worm, who was actually Richard Scarry's persona that he used to represent himself in his books, and you know, just because I could, because I was I'm spending 25 years writing something, I'm gonna have some fun with it also. So this was what was left of that North Atlantic picture, the North Atlantic art and literature, which was an illustration by a Polish tug captain of one of the rescues that's in the Farley Mowat book about Gracie's Under. And it's a Polish ship tug captain who actually moved to Connecticut and became a painter. So that was nice to recognize a crew member who did paintings. And then this was it's a famous photographer who turned out to have the same editor at Norton, David Plowden, who's done like steam, he did a lot with steam engines and locomotives and old barns and industrial like steel plants and stuff, these sort of moody black and white things. So I was happy to have that near the end. Then this is the last page of the book, and this is the Saturn, built in 1906 in Philadelphia, and then eventually made its way up to Boston, and this was on Chelsea Creek in Boston when a guy up there had it. And then it was sold up to Maine Maritime, and then John Johansson, who's a historian, tug historian in Maine, has it now, and he's trying to have somebody take over restoring it. So if you have $75,000 and you'd like a really beautiful old tug, it would be great to see somebody finish the restoration of it, because that, to me, that just sums up what's so beautiful about tugs. That's a classic, 1906. And this was at the end, the book designer said, oh, you know, I'm going to have a page at the end that has all the Library of Congress stuff, and you could throw a picture on there if you want. So I had this picture. It was actually the same guy who took the Great Lakes tug at the beginning, the red and green one, and he had taken this, and I really loved the picture, but I could never use it because I had to be economical and only find pictures that actually told a story, that described whatever it was that I was talking about. So finally, this doesn't tell a story, but I really liked it, and I liked the fact that it was going away, so it made a great end to the book. So. And maybe that'll be the end to the talk also, so if anybody has any questions. Questions, anybody?
Yeah. Is that picture of Gordon by any chance?
Yeah.
Okay, so you know these swingers there.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm very jealous of all the operating bridges in Cleveland, and we can't get them to save one bridge in Boston. So that every time we do a presentation about our bridge, we show like five or six bridges, like we have Bobtail, there's a Bobtail Spring Bridge, and all these things. Yeah,
preserve every one of these.
Yeah, they're great. They're great inspiration.
Well, throughout my lifetime, the swing bridge never worked.
Oh yeah.
Before I moved away, they repaired that.
Yes, in the age of sail, that must have been some really serious seamanship.
Yeah.
Trying to essentially nudge bigger vessels into.
Yeah, I think I think one of the reasons they were like the five-masted schooners from,
yes,
they used to build in Maine.
Right.
I don't think they could have had them if it weren't for tugs. I mean, if they couldn't have had anything that big at a time when they didn't have tugs. So they didn't start making them until like, you know, 1850s or 60s probably.
Yeah. Okay. And prior to that, when it was even sailing ships, bringing in bigger sailing ships.
Yeah.
That had to be some tricky seamanship.
Yeah, I had the one picture of the historic.
Yes.
Shows how they use like warping buoys.
Yes.
They would drop stones with a buoy on top and they'd tie the ship off and then pull themselves to that, and then they'd go to the next one and pull themselves to that. Or use the tides. It was much more dependent on tides than now. So.
Two items. One is, when you don't have a tug, and the ship I was on, you didn't have a tug to come alongside a pier, and there was an offsetting wind, and the executive officer, it was his turn to bring the ship alongside the pier. But when we looked at the bell log down in the engineering compartment, 90 bells to get that ship.
Wow.
Alongside the pier without a tug. And then the guy who had the con, for the rest of that time on the ship, was known as 90 Bells Oil. On your canal boat, there's a few nice songs written about river canals. And one line out of one song popped to my mind as we were throwing that. It says, and the engineer from the bank replied, the horse is doing his best.